Hello, everyone, and welcome to Microsoft Unboxed. We're bringing to you a very special episode this week from the streets of Austin, Texas.
We're here talking to people about how artificial intelligence affects their everyday lives.
All right, let's go see what the people have to say.
All right, bye.
Ooh, I almost got run over.
If I say artificial intelligence or AI, what's the first word that comes to mind?
Innovation.
Possibilities. It's so incredible where we could go with this.
A lot of data.
Think of the Turing test.
Technology that's meant to help humans.
Fearful.
Intelligence. Is that repetitive? I mean, it literally is.
Is there such thing as artificial intelligence as an intelligence? Intelligence?
New frontier. Everything is going to be sort of transformed, sort of business, culture, sort of science.
A lot of people, when they think of artificial intelligence, they think of like all the bad stuff that's going to come with it. I'm excited about it because I know all the stuff that it's going to help.
Sort of morphing of sort of the human presence and the computer presence into one.
It's just going to change so much, and so much is going to happen so fast. It's inspiring.
Do you think that there's any way that artificial intelligence is interacting with your day-to-day life?
I think you use it in ways you don't even really notice.
My phone knows where I am and what I want to eat before I am there. Like, honestly, I'll look at my phone and there'll be an ad to pop up and I'll be like, oh, how did you know I'm across the street from that?
Literally this morning, like, my friend called me and I missed his call, and it like gave me a notification, like it popped up on my screen, like, call back Andrew. And I was like, what? Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah.
Through artificial intelligence, every person that has dealt with a particular diagnosis, we can capture all that information and sort of now disseminate it so that it's, you can do remote medicine.
You know, our phones, sometimes they do like auto corrections and stuff like that.
I buy a lot of things on Instagram, like a lot of things on Instagram, because their targeting is excellent.
I am also a victim of great Instagram advertising.
Absolutely am. Because I use like chatbots for customer service. I wish it would get more intelligent.
Where would you like to see like the future of AI?
Improving my quality of life on a daily basis.
Probably the home. That's where you spend most of our time besides work.
AI that'd be able to predict like what people needed before they even anticipated the need.
So if I can have this artificial intelligence better understanding like what's going on with my customers, what are their needs, what are the questions, and in as human a way as possible.
If we start to understand patterns of human behavior, whether it's helping people get better nutrients to their bodies or get walking more.
Tourism as well, just kind of like with South By. You know, a lot of the AI can help you out with, you know, looking up special events and stuff like that.
That's a great idea, like figuring out the sessions that you would be most likely to enjoy.
Exactly.
I don't know about you, but I was really impressed by everyone's answers to those questions.
Yeah, I was definitely like, wow, everyone really has a handle on AI and has an opinion on it. It was great.
Yeah. Incredibly knowledgeable here on the streets of Austin about artificial intelligence.
People know what's up. How about we go back to Microsoft Lounge and maybe, you know, discuss a little bit more, maybe show some examples of AI in everyday life.
Let's go.
So Colleen and I are now back at the Microsoft Lounge in Austin. It's very cozy and very, you know, foliage filled. Some people didn't realize they engage with AI all the time, and it's really entrenched in our lives. I have a couple of examples of my favorite, like Microsoft services that use AI. I think you have some as well.
I do.
One of my immediate go-to favorite ones is Bing. I worked on Bing for a while, and what I love is when you do search something on Bing, there is a very rich results page at the top. It's not just a blue link, but they actually have, whether you're searching for scores from like the World Cup or anything like that, they actually have a very rich experience at the top that serves up a little bit more content that you can engage with. But additionally, what they're trying to bring in some of these cognitive services and AI is really to help people be more educated. For instance, if you search like, is kale good for you? Right?
It's something benign. That we all need to
something
know.
Something we all might need to know. They're actually going to pull up results that defend both sides of the argument. to really help solidify maybe their own opinions on the matter, and just
or challenge help, their opinions.
Or challenge their opinions. Basically, Bing is providing these multi-perspective responses now and results for people, so they can help create their own opinion.
In a time where there's so much misinformation out there, or the internet feels skewed in a certain way, it's great that you have a location that you can go to see both sides of the of the argument. So I'm gonna be talking about Microsoft Translator. It's near and dear to my heart because I sit on the Azure team.
Yeah.
One of the coolest ways that this comes to life is in PowerPoint live captioning. So it's real-time speech recognition software that is built into this PowerPoint presentation. Maybe you don't necessarily speak the language of the presenter. In near real time, the presentation is translated from speech to text, and the captions show up on the presentation itself. This is built on 10 years, so nearly a decade. 10 years is
a
decade.
That is a decade. Captain Obvious.
This is built. This is built on a decade of natural language processing research.
Awesome.
Of course, if people are hard of hearing or deaf, it allows them to more fully participate in the presentation when it's happening.
Yeah, so I can imagine if we were in a lecture class and maybe I speak a different language than the professor, he can be giving a lecture and the transcription would actually be at the bottom in my language that I would recognize, right?
Yeah, you're exactly right. And that use case actually in particular is a really good one because professors can actually go in and make sure that certain jargon or vocabulary affiliated with the topic gets recognized.
Oh, that's cool.
A speaker might want to program that every time an acronym is used, that it's translated to the full extension of the word.
Yeah, instead of CVP, it says Corporate Vice President.
Exactly.
So my other favorite example is called Resume Assistant. You're on Word and you're using Office 365. If you pull up your resume, it'll actually automatically recognize that you're working on a resume, and it'll pop out this pane. It'll actually provide suggestions of how you can tweak and enhance your resume. So it'll actually scan and look at your career history and pull together a little summary that you can put at the top of your resume. It'll pull in different suggestions of how you can just make it a little bit more robust and designed to just make things pop better. And then the coolest thing is it actually pulls in LinkedIn. It'll see what your latest role is, pull in relevant roles from around your region. So it'll recognize if you're like in Seattle, Washington, here are other comparable roles you could look at. And then the coolest thing is it'll actually pull in your LinkedIn contacts that work at those places so you can ask for a connection.
One thing that I always get tripped up with is making sure that I am using the vocabulary that the rest of the people in my field are using.
Okay, pull in, like I said, similar roles that maybe others have, and it'll pull in suggested terminology or like how you can kind of relay what your work is in a more universal kind of language. It's all integrated into Word so you don't ever have to leave and go back and forth. And yeah, when you're saying that the most difficult thing with resumes was, and you started, I was like, well, hopefully it's not that it's you're trying to get a job because you can't leave me.
You're gonna always be looking for your next job.
Can't go anywhere.
Speaking of going somewhere, we're gonna keep this conversation rolling and we're gonna talk about seeing AI. We've actually talked about seeing AI on the show before.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite applications. Seeing AI is a free app and ongoing research project designed for the blind and low vision community that harnesses the power of AI to open up the visual world and describe nearby people, text, an object. One of my favorite applications of seeing AI was in a Satya Q&A session where he invited some of the Microsoft employees who worked on the app on stage to demo it.
Yep.
And they held up the application to Satya, and because it identifies the visual world around you and describes it, the description was a 40-something-year-old man smiling at you. It was so sweet. But of course, there are applications outside of the walls of Microsoft. Another really cool feature is text recognition. Maybe you're in a restaurant and looking at a menu. This is a great way to navigate that restaurant and make sure you order the best thing on the menu.
Nice.
And it can actually read handwriting. I want to point to what I think is one of the most critical aspects of the Seeing AI app, which is around currency recognition. This could help a blind or low vision person who is perhaps buying something, getting back some change. It could help that person know or feel more confident that they've gotten the right amount of change because the Seeing AI app can narrate that to them.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. It is really evident that AI is really everywhere. It's absolutely enhancing and I think making some of these more mundane or tedious tasks before a lot easier and more streamlined.
In this new era of AI, where it's infused into anything and everything, we are still really committed to a people-first world.
Yeah.
So all of these AI applications are really about amplifying human ingenuity.
So what's up here?
Making it bigger.
Making it bigger and better. So this takes us to our last segment of our show. Outside the box. She did not know I was going to jump her off. We're a little bit more literally outside the box in Austin, so we actually don't have our other third character, our box. So I just have a question for you. Hopefully you have a question for me.
I could think of something.
Okay. Can we please get 30 seconds on the clock? What is the most surprising thing you've seen in Austin?
The most surprising thing has been all of the scooters. We don't have these scooter shares in Seattle,
yeah.
And it is wild how many of them are just zipping around town.
Too many, in my opinion, zipping around town.
It's obviously a really great way to get from one side of the festival to the other side, yeah, in time to make sure you can have the most jam-packed and exciting South by Southwest.
There's literally a line of them right there.
What has been your favorite meal that we've had in Austin?
Okay, we've had so many tacos, and I could keep eating tacos. I would probably say the first tacos we got on Saturday night. It was a kimchi banh mi style taco.
It was delicious.
It was so good. I wanted to basically just keep, like, I stopped talking for a good 20 minutes to everyone because I just kept eating these tacos. It was awesome.
And on a previous episode, you opted for tacos over pizza.
I did. I got a lot of flack for that, by the way. Some people were like, you picked tacos, really? And I think it's because I knew I was coming to Austin and I needed
so
to set myself up for success.
You know I always love answering questions about food, but if you have any questions that you'd like to ask, please remember to send them to the email address below or comment below.
And please remember to subscribe to our channel and share it with friends, colleagues, dogs, you know, scooter buddies. You know, actually, speaking of scooters, I've been meaning to try something else around Austin.
All right, we've had an amazing time in Austin so far. Thank you so much for catching this episode of Microsoft Unboxed. We'll see you next week.
Hey everyone, if you can't get enough of us, I would highly recommend subscribing to our podcast, Women in Business and Technology, available right here.
And you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at our social handles right here.